Welcome back, everyone, to the last day of quarterfinals. The teams are getting set to head back onto the Rift, where KT are up one game over the Kew Tigers. So I'm turning to you first, Yamada. You were the one who picked the Kew Tigers to win this series. They're starting down 0-1. How are they going to get back into it?
The thing is, like, with this game, I was quite satisfied with the strategy. When they pulled the Tahm Kench and TP'd up top lane, they kind of felt that they feel the same way I do. Just put themselves in situations where there are five and they group up and they kind of remove this individual play that KT excels at. And as long as they keep doing that and don't screw up the Dragon, I'm completely satisfied with how Kew Tigers keep playing.
Looking for them to stay grouped as often as possible and push the 5v5s. Crumbs, he just mentioned the attention to the top lane. We expected there to be plenty of it. There was. How do you feel that that top lane matchup is going to develop in this series?
As we've seen the Darius Fiora matchup specifically being such a high skill cap matchup, particularly for Fiora's side, in which she has to repose very carefully as well as position around the Decimate area, they put a lot of focus and just try to gank them a lot, especially with that five-man Tahm Kench creative play. But what they did with the lead that they got to the Fiora just wasn't there. You know, there wasn't a split push presence from either of these teams where they could have easily been. And that was a little disappointing, to be honest, because it felt like the teams just needed some extra time or a little bit of a push so that they understand their composition. Because similar to how we criticize HQ's compositions lacking a lot of wave clear, the exact same case happened when they drafted here. LeBlanc, Kalista, Darius, these guys can't defend the tower for their lives. You put a Veigar and an Ashe into the mid lane and you just drive it home, take a tier two tower. So I think that Kew definitely drafted what they need to win.
Yeah, and you're talking about these top laners going rather even because there was so much blood being spilled in that top lane and then the compositions. But I want to talk about the supports. I feel like both supports played an extraordinarily high-level game here between both Peekaboo and Gorilla. They were standout performers in these. I want to see more of that from them because they were both making plays. But Gorilla was more on a type of, you know, we saw the global play be made in the top lane, but then he was mostly on defensive duties at that point. These are guys who excel in offensive situations where they can create these picks. The Thresh hooks from Peekaboo at the Dragon and in the final fight were what started making it so that they could actually close this game out.
I can't help but wonder that Peekaboo feels more at home with Thresh as opposed to Gorilla on the Tahm Kench, just because Tahm Kench is a lot more defensive than Thresh. When Thresh is a champion, you can say, I want to be aggressive now. It's like, no, I only want to play Lantern bot. And That's not the same thing with the Tahm Kench. It's a lot more safety in the guy.
All right, well, we're on to game two. Let's send it out to our casters to get us into champ select. But first, we'll hear what Someday has his eye out for when drafting against Kew.
강점은 픽뱀부터 한 챔프 다 캐릭 폭이 넓기 때문에 한 챔프를 갖고 돌려쓰는 픽뱀을 많이 써서 그 점을 좀 유의해야 할 것 같고요. 약점은 한번 밀리면 약간 와르르 무너지는 경향이 있는 것 같아서 그 점을 좀 노리면 될 것 같아.
And welcome back, guys, to KT Kew Electric Peekaboo. It's the sequel to a semi-final matchup from OGN Champion Summer. And game one, it was already pretty tight.
It's only Electric Peekaboo if he plays Kennen.
So that's true. Hopefully we'll get that.
We'll have to wait for the Electric
Peekaboo. The true Electric Peekaboo at that
point. Flex pick Kennen.
That's right.
Well, I'm interested to see this because we just saw that little video of Someday talking about Kew's playstyle.
Yeah.
Well, this is the time where maybe they can't ban out the Kennen or some of these flex picks because KT is going to have to ban out the GP, we would assume. Well, Mordekaiser, and there's the Azir ban. Now, this is what Kew did on blue side in their last best of five.
Yeah, KT Rolster versus Kew Tigers picks and bans for game two. Tahm Kench and Darius banned out from KT. Lulu, the second ban from the Kew Tigers, and Mordekaiser on blue side. Interesting. GP for KT.
Yeah.
Interesting.
It felt like KT was trying to pinch the Gangplank Mordekaiser trade.
Yeah.
And when you recognize that's happening as a blue side team, you can ban one of the two, and then it almost forces KT to ban the final one, which in turn will give Hojin the Elise, which is, I think, exactly what he wanted.
Oh, yeah. If there's any champion that Hojin can pick if he has the choice, it will definitely be Elise these days if he doesn't get the Rek'Sai. So KT over on the other side, they can go ahead and take this Jinx if they want to.
KT, when we saw them in the group stage, as the group stage dragged on, when they were on red side, they loved taking the Jinx in the first round of the draft. So this will be a different strategy. They do definitely have the counter pick for someday in this game if they choose to use it. So Rek'Sai Jinx stays right in line with what we've seen from KT so far on the red side of Worlds.
Yeah, nice. Score certainly not disappointed with that Rek'Sai pickup.
Yeah, and I also feel like the Jinx is almost Arrow's replacement for Kog'Maw.
Yeah.
It was Kog'Maw, and it was working well for them. They won victories, but they saw everyone else doing amazing things with Jinx and seemed to have picked it up for themselves, even though Arrow not traditionally a Jinx player.
I'll score switching it over to Gragas at the last second, so he's going to take more of a bit of a playmaking jungler. And are we going to see the cannon now picked up by Ku?
Has been something that's worked for them for a long time. Of course, Kalista still on the table too, so that is champion that we could see come to play here, but they're going to perhaps lock in that Fiora, which would mean they have something different in that top lane, and it will be a support Shen for Gorilla.
Yeah, taking that one away from KT. Pickaboo had played it, not to mention Someday being a great top Shen player. Now, how is KT going to respond here? Probably not with Zillion. Rek'Sai seems reasonable.
Yeah, well, this time there's no Darius to go up against the Fiora. Someday would love to play Renekton. It used to be almost his Achilles heel that he would play Renekton into any situation.
It used to be like his only champion, back when.
This would be an interesting matchup because Fiora could turn the Renekton stun around on him with the proper timing.
It's true.
I don't know if it's that good of a matchup for Renekton. He does have slow alligator-like movements, and Fiora can quickly respond to them.
It's somebody's most played champion of all time. I suspected it would come out, especially after we saw Marin play it, because he's played it off meta quite a bit, and it will be that Renekton.
Yeah, and if anybody is going to be able to take that into the Fiora matchup and avoid those things we just talked about, it's going to be Someday. He is a Renekton main through and through, so we'll see if he's got what it takes in this matchup.
Yeah, these last two picks will be very important for Ku, but KT actually, even though the only duplicate pick for them from last game is the Gragas, they have a very strong tank line right now behind the Jinx, which is common and good against the Fiora.
Caitlyn picked up for the Ku Tigers, and there's the Veigar as well for Kuro in the mid lane.
Wow.
Interesting priority on that from the Ku Tigers today. I did not expect that.
But again, very defensive teams here. We have the Shen coming in to help protect Prey, and Kuro on the backside, not a lot of engage, so the Ku Tigers once again looking to get in front of objectives and kite it out.
I kind of like the Syndra actually here. I mean, you've got that long range stun. Just in general, you have range that's going to be able to work around what Veigar can do to you in the mid lane.
I would need to stay out of range of the Veigar. I think it's such a hard thing to pick against. Ku Tigers will have to execute better than they did last game because they picked a very similar team composition.
What about Zed? What about LeBlanc?
I think LeBlanc, I mean, they played the matchup on both sides and they were the victors last game.
Worked out last time, true. And they're going to try to make it work this time as well. Nagne going to be taking that LeBlanc once again to the mid lane.
I'm a bit surprised about the Renekton pick into Fiora for the reasons Jat stated earlier. And Gorilla going to play Shen support for the first time ever professionally. Now, you have to remember that while Shen support was very common in the LCS, we really didn't see it in Korea at all.
Yep.
But since Worlds has started, Pickaboo has had a game on it. Now this is Gorilla's first game. So they're definitely liking what they're picking up from some of these Western teams.
Yeah. Well,
and this kind of extends Gorilla's massive support champion pool this tournament as well. Now, you know, the only champion that he's played twice is still Tom Kench.
Yeah, seven different champions out of eight games for a support player. Certainly not something that you see very often, considering that support pools tend to be quite small in most metas, just preferring just a couple of power picks, but there's been a lot of flexibility here at the World Championship.
It's also the fifth different AD carry Prey has been playing, and this Caitlyn must be doing amazing things in scrims,
because
this is not a pick that was played pretty much anywhere prior to this World Championship in this season, and all the top AD carries have been spamming it in solo queue, and this is the third different player we've seen pull it out in the quarterfinals.
I mean, she's still got the same strength she always had. Long range, high damage late game, the ability to poke soft targets out before teams' fights begin, sieging. Mm-hmm. So we'll see if she can do it here in game number two. Hashtag Ku win or hashtag KT win at LOL Esports, and let us know who you think is going to take game two. Will KT tie it up, or will KT get the 2-0 lead? I think it can really go either way.
And looking at Prey historically as a player, this is actually his third most played champion in his career, Caitlin. Yeah. We tend to think of Prey more as a Trinity Force user, and of course his two most played are Ezreal and Corki, but this has been his go-to auto attack AD carry pick for a long, long time.
And when we say long time, we're saying going on almost 4 years now. Yeah. I mean, Prey has been a pro player for probably one of the oldest pro players in Korea in terms of time he's been in the booth or at the desk.
Whatever.
Whatever. In front of a computer, playing League of Legends, whatever.
The gaming table.
That's right.
But really, Caitlyn's about the lane superiority.
Yeah.
A lot of the way that it's fallen off is because teams just lane swap to Caitlyn, and then champions like Jinx and Tristana can kill the turrets more quickly. But if Ku manages to follow Arrow's Jinx with Prey's Caitlyn, expect to see Prey gain a pretty substantial CS advantage because Caitlyn will just headshot the Jinx from outside of Jinx's auto attack range again and again. And also, Arrow doesn't have any way of closing that gap. Like, this is a really bad straight-up matchup for the Jinx.
I mean, the one nice thing is that he does have the Braum in lane to at least block some of that damage, maybe jump in front when the Caitlyn ult is activated during that channel.
Agreed.
But I think the question kind of remains with what was brought up on the analyst desk as well, too. You know, can Kuro and the rest of the Ku Tigers keep that five-man pressure on? You know, can they keep grouping, making KT react to them instead of letting KT play that broad pushing style? Broad vision style that they've been making work.
Well, Ku is obviously, in spite of that loss, very confident that they're going to be able to make this work because they're playing another kiting composition with even less engage. They got a little bit more pick pressure with the Elise, but KT on the engage end of things with that Grog is certainly superior, so they have more options when it comes to initiating teamfights. So we have to see better Veigar play out of Kuro. And it's been weird because I feel this tournament, Kuro surprised me in that I felt that he was really overperforming during the group stage. Mm-hmm. And maybe he has normalized. Nagne, conversely, underperformed that week one, got it together by the time week two rolled around. It was much more like the Nagne that we're used to seeing.
Yeah, definitely.
Nagne had some of the worst stats of all mid laners in week one.
Well, he just looked despondent too after that first week. He knew he could play better. He was really letting his team down. Kind of felt lucky that they were getting the wins they were getting. And so, yeah, we really saw revitalized Nagne in week two and in game one today as well. Smeb versus Someday, yet again, Smeb trying out that Fiora for the second game in a row. So far, the trades have been going pretty good for Someday.
But about even so far. Someday playing a little bit off the wave. And be interesting to see how this plays out because we haven't seen the Renekton up against this Fiora yet at Worlds.
Yeah.
To me, it feels like a matchup that Fiora will actually be able to win a little bit early until Renekton gets a little bit more resiliency because the damage over time from Renekton, once he's able to pop his ultimate, if he can avoid the Grand Duel from Fiora, I think it would give Renekton a small edge there, but I'm really fascinated to see all these lanes play out because this was a very mirrored start by both teams. You can see the junglers are doing pretty much the same path to the jungle. Both top laners started with the double jungle. The Caitlyn is straight up against the Jinx. And that is where the advantage is going to be gained, not as much through team play as we're used to seeing, but more through just straight up laning, kind of a classic matchup here.
Yeah, pretty much. Praying Gorilla trying to put that pressure on to Arrow and Peekaboo like we talked about. Prey using that long auto attack range. And Gorilla, of course, always there with that threat of the taunt. Crab walking his way around the bot lane. Aren't you glad Shen's back, Bobby?
I'm not.
I'm thrilled. Really, even after becoming Shen?
Yeah, we were two Shen. That's true.
That's true. We became a Shen. You know, sometimes
even
you
after
live
walking,
long enough to become the Shen.
Walking like 500 feet in Shen shoes, you still do not sympathize.
I feel a kinship with Shen now.
I knew what it was like to be the world's worst ninja for a short period of time.
Yeah, I mean, we're commentators. We're loud and very obvious, aren't we? So that just like Shen, the ninja.
Just as illogical as a tank ninja.
Makes sense. Support ninja. Makes way more sense. Ojin lurking about for a gank. Someday comes in with a stun. Smeb wasn't able to block that one.
This could be a pretty big brawl.
Oh yeah, Smeb coming in. Smeb very low already. Can he get taken out? He will. First blood goes to Someday, and now they're going to chase Hojin out of lane. A flash used. Repel coming down, and not going to be able to finish off Hojin, it looks like. Oh, maybe they are. Whoa, that was really close.
Huge credit right here to KT Score for making that gank happen so quickly. By closing the distance with his flash immediately, he almost invalidated the counter gank. Renekton wants the 2v2, so does it Gragas. Also, he had faster jungle pathing, so the Gragas had a level advantage on the elites regardless of the result of that gank. So KT just played that almost perfectly, so there was no counterplay available.
Until a moment ago, he was two levels ahead on Hojin.
Yeah, somebody did pop the second W a little bit early, though, from the rappel, and so had to hit a minion before the rappel came down. That could have maybe been a double kill, but a little bit of an error. He's back again. Oh, boy.
Smeb in big trouble. There's the stun. Smeb trying to get away, but no flash, and he's going to get taken out nearly. Oh, wow, there we go. Someday gets the kill. The turret doing a lot of damage, and the stun from Kuro barely doesn't catch him. Oh, Someday.
This is now a massive hole for Smeb, because Someday's already hit the point of being level 6, so even if it's a 1v1 or 1v2, Renekton is actually kind of classic for 1v2ing when the jungle ganks you once he's ahead in the lane. Someday is good at League of Legends, and he's ahead.
Yeah, and that gank, too, was such a mind game. So what happened there, they kill Smeb, and there's a huge minion wave coming to the turret, so they know that Smeb is going to TP back immediately. So Score, he's two levels up on Hojin, was 5-3, sits in the brush, and you don't expect Someday to use his teleport to come back into lane when the minion wave is pushed. So they immediately turn around and gank that. So a great mind game on the second gank there from KT. Really nice jungling from Score.
It's one of my favorite things to do. If you can kill the top laner, get him to burn the teleport back, and just never leave the lane, because normally it's such a large investment to kill him, wait in the brush for him to walk back. But if you can predict that he's going to teleport back, it's actually also an efficient gank as well as an incredibly effective gank. You can see Score's level 6 now. He's leveling with the solo lanes. He is a monster now, because now he can gank with his ultimate.
That's crazy. I don't think I've ever seen you so happy, Jet.
Hey, when...
Oh, jungle play.
Smart, efficient jungle play, though. Not just all this ward and be a sightstone right away. Just like being so efficient. Of course, he built a sightstone right away.
So
but it's still impressive.
You're really a bloodthirsty jungler then, aren't you?
Well, absolutely.
All right, I can agree with that.
He had the farm advantage. He got the two assists. So you have to think about it like a free sightstone, Jack. He's still, you know, still trailblazer to trailblazer. He hasn't really lost anything. And here we go again.
Oh, Smeb. Able to get out of that one, but you just cannot get close to this Renekton right now. He's doing too much damage. He's got that pickaxe and a longsword on top of just the two Doran's blades and a ruby crystal for Smeb. It's bad for Smeb, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
And Smeb life is not good right now.
All right, tried to block the stun there, didn't work. Someday gonna pop the ultimate grand challenge used by Smeb. Here comes Hojin. They're gonna lock Renekton down, and actually Smeb and Hojin get the kill. Nice gank by the Ku Tigers.
Well, you know, Doa, sometimes when you don't have wards in the river, you shouldn't be trying to all-in your opponent.
Yes.
Heard that.
Someday, getting very greedy and misplaying that entirely.
No
without
jungle
knowledge
backup
of Hojin or with help from Score. Pretty sloppy.
Score. He's like, hey, I'm here to... Oh.
Be efficient.
Already died. I see how it is.
Here to be... Come on.
Right. See, does this make you mad as a jungler now, Jack? Because you get your lane ahead, and then he just goes and dies, and you're not there. Like, what did I do all that work for?
It makes you a little angry, I would have to say, especially because he's allowed to play that aggressive, Someday is, as long as Smeb isn't level 6. Because he would be able to 2v2 an Elise and Fiora as long as he doesn't have Grand Challenge on him. But credit to Hojin as well for flashing out of the brush there in order to get Someday before he could slice and dice away. And it was a well-executed gank by Ku, but at the same time, Someday should never have put himself in that position. And honestly, the advantage is gone until he gets teammate.
Game 2 is a roller coaster in the top lane and a roller coaster of emotion for Jet.
And there finally Smeb gets the riposte stun, turns it right around on Someday.
Yep.
It's been a bit of a mind game as to when that W would come out so far. And Someday's mostly managed to avoid getting the stun turned around, but that time really taking a pretty harsh turnaround in that little trade.
You know, we saw Someday get picked on early on in game one, and then Someday was able to turn it back around. Now we're kind of seeing the reverse, where they're picking on Smeb, and he's starting to finally turn it around.
Yep, very similar to last game.
Yep.
Get Someday ahead, Someday makes a mistake, Someday starts to fall behind, Someday, the third step of this is Someday gets an excellent teleport and totally owns a team fight, so.
And he can definitely do that on a champion like Renekton.
Now he's got Tiamat on Renekton, which is the go-to item, since after you use your W stun, you can then Tiamat, which allows you to get more damage off more quickly because normally you're frozen in a half-second animation with the stun, but Tiamat can break that.
Jetpacks. Oh, challenge time. Yeah. Someday could be in a bit of trouble slicing and dicing away. Can Hojin get there in time with the cocoon? Smeb's going to go ahead and flash to Chase,
he
going under
it.
The turret. He gets a heal. Someday gets taken down, and it looks like Smeb's going to make it out.
Well, coming in, that was another time where Smeb saw the opening, turned around the stun onto Someday when he tried to come in. Smeb started playing that little interaction poorly.
Well, here we go
on the bottom side.
Whoa, nice ult from Score. Prey nearly taken down immediately. Peekaboo helps Score pick that one up, and Gorilla has a flash, gets stunned, goes down. There's a kill for Arrow.
And that's that's catastrophic because they did a double teleport cancel there.
Yeah.
Both Kuro and Smeb were channeling the teleports and neither of them decided to complete.
But they were on different minions, and what Arrow did was he managed to trap both teleport locations with Jinx at the same time. So kind of forcing the cancel a little bit right there, but a good gank turns it around to Hojin and Nagde, mixing it up in the jungle.
And we've been really critical of the top lane matchup, Smeb and Someday, but we haven't been able to pay much attention to the bottom lane matchup. The Jinx has actually been winning that lane and now is definitely winning that lane thanks to Score. Even though Caitlyn does have, in my opinion, an advantage over the Jinx, Shen is an incredibly lackluster support in the laning phase as far as being able to win, especially against a Braum. So I feel like Peekaboo and Arrow, as well as outplaying, have been utilizing that supporting lane advantage to actually give Jinx the laning advantage against a Caitlyn, which is not what Ku would expect or what they wanted when they picked in with a Caitlyn.
Well, it's been interesting, and at the end of the day so far, it's a 2,000 gold lead for KT Rollster.
Well, I mean, they got the turret. They have a TP advantage. They will soon have a double TP advantage once Nogmaze comes back up. So KT, this is their time to start making plays on the map, really aggressively going after this dragon if they can.
Yeah.
Push up that lane and start taking objectives while Ku is weak in terms of their globals.
Yeah, pushing up that bot lane as well. They've already got wards deep, deep into the enemy jungle. And if you look at the mini-map right now, I feel like this is exactly the type of game that KT tries to play every game. Get those wards in there deep, get them in early, and then use that to set up dragons, use that to set up more plays. Like, this is all KT so far.
Mm-hmm, because right after they killed that turret bottom lane, they got the wards for the dragon. They're always prepping their play. It's the mark of a good team.
Very true.
And now they have the teleport advantage. So what actually would be likely is a play top lane because they can still teleport down. They're actually not exposing themselves to a dragon here.
Oh, challenge issued to Someday. Teleport's coming in for KT, though. Smeb's going to have to give that one up. Teleport canceled by Nagne. There's one down.
They couldn't get Smeb to fully commit to that, which was smart of Smeb.
Yep.
Drop the ultimate, so it looks like he's going in. They force the TP in out. Score wandering.
Score goes into the blue buff, uses his ult, pushes Hojin back towards him, somehow stays alive for the moment, but Kuro comes in for the kill. Blue buff got quite the show there.
Yeah, they didn't actually have Arrow in the right position to make that invade at the time. If they had waited just a little bit longer, but Arrow's still going to get the turret, so all in all, a preferable trade for KT, but not without a price.
Yeah, because we have to remember, KT had a numbers advantage up in that lane.
Yep.
Prey was down bottom trying to push the turret, so as long as they grouped appropriately, they would have had the brute force to get the deep wards they so desire. It was actually a very good play by Ku to catch Score while Arrow was up top trying to push down the turret.
Yeah, and Hojin has opted to try and get that Sheen this game and go into Runeglaive. So there is a ton of single target damage on the Ku Tigers. If you get caught out like that, they can blow you up nearly immediately. Of course, with champions like Caitlyn, that high single target damage, Fiora, and Veigar.
The question is, while you're focusing that single target, you know, what are the other two carries going to be doing to you? I mean, they've got Renekton and a LeBlanc in this game, so it's not like other comps you've seen where it's just about the Jinx damage. Ku has a lot to worry about.
Yeah, they do, and Someday really going for a high damage build here, going Phage out of Tiamat. So not gonna be very tanky when it comes to dealing with a lot of this burst, looking for that split push. First dragon of the game, going to go over to KT Rollstar.
Yep, taking that without any issue at all. There it goes. So Ku got the first one in game one. KT takes it in game two.
And this, I think, was the expected result with the teleport advantage and the play they made top lane. If Ku wanted to respond to the dragon play, then KT would then be able to rotate very quickly down bottom. But again, a single target pick in the jungle.
Peekaboo needs to be careful here. Uses that ult, actually gets a knock up on the gorilla, but Hojin just repels away. I don't know about that at all. What do you think?
No, I think it's actually quite good because it's zoned them out of that jungle, which is allowing Arrow to push forward in this bottom side. They get the deep wards in as well. So they're going to get a little damage from it, but it protects Arrow, prevents any kind of engage, and continues to allow KT to get the deep wards in the bottom jungle.
Very true. Nagne, bringing a bit to Kuro again, able to blink back over the wall with that distortion.
It really is all about the deep wards that they're setting up.
Yeah. It's a very classic KT Rollster play here in game two.
The desk has talked a lot about it, but yep. 4.3 wards per minute for this KT team. We do see the sweeper once again early on to Nagne.
Interesting.
Same thing last game. He did it about half the time in the group stages as well, where he does early sweeper, but then he will upgrade to a warding sweep. But the interesting thing this game will be, since they already have so much map priority, if he's even going to bother. Going back and getting the upgraded warding trinket.
And that tier 2 and bottom is nearly ready to fall, already down to about a fourth of its health left. And KT has a lot of time before the next dragon to just simply put pressure on these lanes.
And Prey, it's Caitlyn, one of these champions that has a relatively lackluster mid game, really needs 3 to 4 items to be successful, so you have to wait quite a long time to get her relevant.
Especially if you get an Avarice Blade.
Yeah. I mean, it's no damage here and no damage coming anytime soon, really, for Prey. He's done a good job of keeping up in CS, and Score has been standing in a ward for a real long time now.
Yeah, that's good for Ku, that's for sure.
Yeah. Well, if they can do anything about it.
The map.
Score is the ultimate ward defender here.
Cool guys stand in enemy team's wards.
Both junglers are in wards right now. So.
I rest my case.
The ultimate green jungler battle.
Here we go.
Gorilla tries to flash head for the stun onto Arrow, or the taunt rather. Doesn't work out. He's going to use that exhaust. Summoner heal just to give the speed boost for Arrow and Peekaboo to make it out.
Yeah, that's pretty massive right there. They burned double TP again for nothing. That's the second time Ku has done that. And you really need to use your double TP to get back in the game in these situations.
And this is the situation that we talked about in the about this point last game.
Oh, Gorilla, gotta be careful there.
So last game what happened was we saw the TPs used and we saw the 5-man groups and they were able to force fight and get killed. Now the adaptation here, and what I said is the kind of dark side of that play, is now we see a lot of minions being lost on the top side, mid lane turret goes down. So KT has adapted. Last game, they were taking those fights when the TPs came in, when the groups came in. This time, no. They burned Flash, they burned Rommel, just to get out of that situation. And instead of taking those fights, they say, we're backing off, we're just going to play the map against you. So KT now has a lead at this point in the game, whereas they had a deficit before. So Ku has to come up with something else now.
Yeah, I also think the way they achieve that reward is more important. So KT, this time, has the vision generally of the approaching play instead of Ku having the vision of KT. KT has done a good job denying the vision and keeping the deep wards up, which makes it easier to make the appropriate choice, which they have adapted to do well.
Well, KT pushed out for the moment anyway. He's going to need a lot more than that. Already 4,000 gold down. That's a massive deficit for them at this point in the game.
Especially considering that Ku came into this match tonight with an average 5,772 gold lead at the 20-minute mark.
That's incredible.
So absolutely enormous. Certainly it was helped by the CLG games where they were sometimes up 7, 8, 9,000 gold.
They averaged a 9,000 gold lead against CLG at 20 minutes.
That is not much of a challenge, is it? Well, KT. Going for that tier 2, it's nearly dead. Probably get it pretty soon. Smeb making trouble for Peekaboo here. They're going to go in. Very tentative from both sides.
Everywhere KT goes, they can match with teleport. So this is exactly how KT wants to play the 15 to 30 minute mark right here. They're farming 3 waves with the protection of their teleports. This entire window, after Ku made the failed double teleport play by both pressing the teleport key at the same time and not getting kills, puts them in a hole for the duration of that 5-minute teleport cooldown.
Uh-oh.
They need to instantly kill someone on KT in order to make a proper play. Otherwise, the teleports will come in and stop the play dead in its tracks.
Nice. Speaking of stopping things dead in their tracks, Peekaboo getting in front of that piece in the hole from Prey. Not bad at all.
No red buff. here will be taken away and put onto Nagne, actually.
Hey, what LeBlanc doesn't want a red buff, right?
Just get some more damage in there. Just weave an auto attack into your combo.
If you're taking TP instead of Ignite, you might as well get the red buff, right?
It's a baby Ignite. It's a true damage. Like Ignite over time.
Yeah. See?
On auto attacks. And
there you go.
There was once a time in League of Legends where that applied on spells for like a patch. And they realized,
I remember that.
Then they realized Ryze's Q was a little bit too good with red buff.
I would say so. Enjoyed playing Annie during that time, too. Dragon is up. And we will see if KT can claim it. They've certainly got the map positioning to go back and take that one fairly easily. Someday just pushing up the top lane. Got his teleport. In fact, the TP advantage for KT, and they're going to use it to go after that dragon very safely.
Incredibly safe. There is no chance of a steal.
Yep. That's right. This wasn't Dragon Funland after all.
No.
No. KT 2-0 up in Dragons. And Koo Tigers just kind of scrambling for some semblance of control, anything they can do to just stay alive in this game. Now, I suppose in theory they could still find a miracle team fight, but again, you know, that's not a situation you really want to find yourself in.
Yeah, specifically because KT Rolster has a stronger front line and very good catch potential this game as well. Obviously, Koo can get a good event horizon down and if they can somehow catch Nagne very quickly, especially with Peekaboo being on Braum and not being near a Mikhail's or having any cleanses on KT. It's kind of on Hojin or Kuro to make that happen, but it's very unlikely with the ward coverage that KT has and also the way they're splitting the map into three different lanes.
Yeah.
This is pretty much going to script. We talked about it, 15 to 30. KT, number one in terms of CS during that period. And Koo falling behind in that regard, but having a lot more kills. But KT, they just refuse to fight. They have long games, but they're happy because what happens, this style from KT, yes, it results in longer games, but it's so controlled. Just retreat, keep the map pressure up, slowly deny minion waves to your opponents, take these dragons, get the deep wards in, and just never give your opponent an opening. And when they make those mistakes with those global spells like teleport, just punish them for it.
Yeah, very true. And we talked about this coming into the match today as well. KT has a 9-minute longer average game time at Worlds than the Koo Tigers do right now. Koo Tigers have really relied in that group they were in on getting a lead early, snowballing it like crazy, and finishing fast. And against KT, clearly that is not something you can do. Someday, taking some damage from Smeb, though, he's going to have to slice and dice his way out of there before he gets sliced and diced even more. There's a lot of slicing and dicing going on there.
Yeah, Someday's gone for an incredibly aggressive Renekton build and opted against building any armor items, which is a little surprising. Although I do like heavy AD Renekton builds, he actually has some of the most aggressive AD ratios on his spells. So as far as which champions you would want to build AD on, Renekton is one of them. He gets a lot of natural health from his ultimate, especially once he hits level 16 as well. But I want Ninja Tabi or just a Warden's Mail somewhere in that build because I think as soon as he builds that item, he just wins straight up against Smed.
Wow, Koo pushing right up the mid lane. Can they actually take a turret here? They've got pressure on
the
lane too. Wow, Nagne did get stunned. They take him out. Hojin with a kill there. Nice pick by Koo, and that's exactly what they were looking for. Challenge issued. Smeb taking turret hits. He's okay for the moment, though. Someday in a bit of trouble. Getting lower goes down, and that heal combined with the ult from Shen keeps him alive. Koo suddenly finding an opening.
That was absolutely huge. They cut the gold deficit by about half by that. It's going to go down even further as Smeb takes a turret, so Koo roaring right back into this game.
I guess, man.
I mean, I'm not really seeing this Fiora Renekton matchup at the current time because at these two items, it's really hurting Renekton to be in these dueling situations. It's too easy for Smeb to block the stun now.
Yep, I think Someday needs armor. He can't win that duel elsewhere. And this was a mistake by Nagne. Obviously, with the Veigar, we talk about how strong he is as Seize potential. This is exactly why. If Nagne wants to clear the wave, he has to walk into Event Horizon range or just give up a turret. He ends up losing both. So really, Koo losing the split push war that they had been winning this entire time because Koo kind of smartens up and just sets up a siege.
Yeah, they start to group up, and then not only that, Gorilla on point to get into that bottom lane to make a play and a dive with Smeb at the same time, so they're able to crack two of the outer turrets. KT had held on to all of them before that single play. And Ku getting right back into it.
And one wonders what else Ku has planned here as they push up the mid lane.
I think, as far as plans go, this is 100% of their plan. They should continue to push up mid lane as much as possible,
right,
and at least match a split push. They don't need Smeb in the same lane as Sunday, even though that's nice, but as long as they can trade turrets in a split push, they're keeping the gold close and maintain a presence mid lane. They no longer have teleport disadvantages, so they can set up a decently safe siege.
Well, they're going to get that top lane turret pretty easily. Smeb tearing it apart right now. Looks like they'll trade the top lane tier 1 for the bottom lane tier 2. And you know, that's not ideal, but it's better than nothing. Wow, Smeb actually hasn't killed that. He hasn't done any damage to that turret yet. Someday, what are you doing?
He's trying to get out of this situation. He knows he's getting collapsed on, so it's still a dicey maneuver, and there's the maneuver right out of Hojin's way. Very well played there by Someday escaping. It could have been a very deadly situation.
Three people collapsed on him, and he made it out completely cleanly. That's so impressive by Someday right there.
Yeah, Shen is like, wow, I need to get sneaking lessons from that giant space crocodile.
A better ninja than Shen.
Literally anything.
That box that like Solid Snake walks around under in Metal Gear, that's a better representation of a ninja than Shen,
yes,
I think.
Yes, it is. Absolutely. Yeah.
What's in the box? Oh, nothing. Just a box. Shen's like, oh, that guy's so good.
Why didn't I think of that?
I was too busy making loud noises and appearing on the other side of the map.
So, oh, here I come! Shen. Supposed to be subtle. Nothing subtle about Ku's comeback, though. The lane's starting to push a little bit more for KT, but Ku has made it a game.
Yeah. Well, the possibility, though, of KT really stacking up these dragons is becoming quite troublesome.
Yeah.
Nogne's going to take a free bullet.
It's not a ton of damage.
I think that's KT's next step. Set up the dragon as cleanly as possible, make Curl burn Event Horizon, and then find your fight after that moment. A lot of that will have to do on Nogne's flanks.
Yeah.
Who's going to go a little early?
KT wants to take this one. Ku doesn't want to let them. Prey doing a bit of damage to the dragon. Who's going to get it? Red team takes it, went over to score. Smited it just in time, and that's going to be 3-0 in dragons for KT. Ku thinking back to game one, saying, wait, this is our moment. Come on, third dragon, guys.
Hojin smited at 970 right there before Score was even comboing abilities, so a really easy smite there for Score to finish. But with Someday trying to split push bottom, it's the setup siege again in the mid lane. Event Horizon equals turret.
Yeah.
And Someday actually peeled off right there, got cold feet. Of course, it would have been difficult for him on his own to try and take that inhibitor turret. But he did make the move, did push the minion wave, and they ended up. KT doesn't have a lot of tools to safely clear that minion wave as long as the Event Horizon is there. So Ku playing this Veigar significantly better than they did the last time, but the problem remains. Two dragons for KT, and they'll get it before 40 minutes. That fifth dragon buff is very scary. And Ku, if they don't have the opportunity to get vision first on the dragon, they cannot engage really with their composition.
Now that's the big threat, isn't it? Then you have to think about what Nagne is really going to start doing in team fights. You get that fifth dragon stack, and suddenly you're going to be just evaporating people like Kuro if you can get close enough. If you can get that flank.
But you also have to remember the late game Veigar, once he gets Void Staff, is going to be near 1,000 ability power. Nagne has built pretty heavy magic resist with Mercury Treads and Abyssal Scepter, but we've even seen Nagne's experienced it. Veigar is just pressing one button and instantly killing him in the late game.
Yeah, and that's when he had Merc Dreads, Abyssal Scepter, and a Rylai's. So even more tankiness than he has right now.
Yeah. They're using Kuro to push up that bot lane for the moment anyway. And it seems like for now, it's really a lot about Baron too. Can KT maybe find an opportunity to start baiting it, start pulling people away, and help Someday get a little bit more split pushing pressure with that Baron threat?
Well, they really want to force a face check here because Ku's engage crowd control is so poor. And Ku's way of winning a lot of these team fights is going to be through picks or through kiting. So as long as they can control the river, as we reach the end game. Definitely a duel going on at the top side right now.
Yeah, Someday on the run. Here comes Hojin. Someday could be in a bit of trouble here. A lot of Ku members collapsing. There's the flash. Someday still trying to get away, could get to the mid lane. Gorilla over the wall with the taunt. Someday slices and dices his way out. Caitlyn comes in with a bit of damage. Oh, they got him with the Event Horizon. Will that be enough damage? Gorilla gets taken up by Nogne, though. There goes the support on the other side. And Smeb, a little bit of health left. He's got enough. Another nice stun with that Event Horizon. Score manages to body slam his way to freedom. Here comes Nogne trying to find a target. Takes a lot of damage response. Nice flash from Prey with the headshot. And Ku comes out of that fight on top.
Really, chaos ensued once Smeb chased Someday. Someday's really, really good at getting away from stuff, but KT did overcommit when trying to protect their Renekton. He burned far too many spells in retreat, which then gave an advantageous fight for Ku, and specifically the fact that Ku didn't have to deal with frontline allowed them to just chase with their CC. Now it's all about this Baron and whether or not Score could miraculously get a smite.
Needs to
Arrow's
be a hero
here as well.
Here. Oh, but there's the Event Horizon. Score.
Still body slam in.
It was a bit early. Got such low health, though. Arrow tried to come in. No, they can't quite get it. Baron goes down, and so does Nogne. Ku taking that Baron, and suddenly everything going the Ku Tiger's way, but only for the moment. They've got low health. Peekaboo trying to slow people up, and it looks like they'll be able to escape the Baron pit anyway.
Yeah, that was such a good call from Ku. They knew the TPs were down, as well as the death timers on the mid and top lane. Nogne had no chance because he tried to TP into that last fight. If they had just let Someday to die or tried to disengage with the Braum ultimate, it could have been very different, not burn that TP. They decided to go in, follow that up, but Ku had been chasing Someday around for too long, and KT really overcommitted when Ku could just kite very efficiently.
I also think after the fight, an incredibly risky Baron call. Jinx over the wall with Jinx rockets, as well as an attempted smite steal where, by the way, neither smite was actually used. So if either one of those guys would have gotten close to smite, it could very easily have been a Baron steal because Score got into the pit.
Funny thing is Jinx rocket wasn't used either.
Yeah. Was the ultimate
was down at the time. That could be it. All right, nice flash taunt onto Someday there from Gorilla.
Yeah, but the thing is, he had to use Dominus before this fight. Someday never does damage here, and the LeBlanc arrives when the other soul laner is already dead. Trading a top laner for a support automatically puts Ku at the advantage, not to mention they got to fight on top of that healing spring from Smeb. And really, Nogne can never get the proper flank position in this battle.
This is the real mistake, though. Nogne has no reason to go in for a LeBlanc combo right there. The AD carry in jungle had already successfully disengaged, and Nogne getting chunked and dying on the flank is what caused that Baron to go down. So, team fighting error there from Nogne.
Kuro hitting things so well with that Event Horizon.
Yeah, looking much better this game than last game.
And with the Baron buff, this composition hits its sweet spot, because specifically with the Caitlyn, the three item Caitlyn right here, the Event Horizon plus the Caitlyn range can take down almost any turret.
Oh, here we go again. Smeb onto Someday, issuing the grand challenge, and Someday can't even survive it through the ultimate. Oh yeah, Smeb 6-2-2 all over that top lane.
I know this may look like Fiora is just a way better champion than the Renekton in a split push, but this is a magic resist stacking Renekton trying to deal with the split push from Fiora. I do not know what Someday is doing with that build, and it is consistently punishing KT.
He's trying to survive Kuro, but that's not the person he's been fighting against.
I mean, but by not building armor, the other problem is that Prey has not had to build a Last Whisper this game either, so it's making it very easy for Prey to output damage and get tanky with that Bloodthirster.
Someday had 87 armor during that death, 33 minutes into the game. But Ku, they have the Veigar anyway, so they are pushing so strong here.
Yeah, using that Baron buff to push through the bottom inhibitor, going all the way to a bit of damage on the Nexus turret. Someday, he's teleporting down. They're going to try to flank this. Ku could be in trouble. Nice taunt from Gorilla, catching Someday immediately after he comes to the teleport. Score uses his ultimate, but he can't save his top laner. Smeb is godlike with a kill there. Nogne comes in, nearly takes out Prey, but it's not enough. Oh, Nogne lives with like zero health left. 42 remaining after that ace in the hole.
Jinx coming in on the bottom side, right, or top side, rather. Smeb going hunting for Score, but the only one there, Score trying to
but he's in trouble. Smeb's like, four score and seven kills ago, I took out a Gragas in the mid lane. Meanwhile, Dragon taken by Ku as well. Looks like Score lives anyway.
Very close. They had to burn the exhaust. Enough slows used, though, to keep Score alive. Only Someday going down. They thought they might be able to catch them coming out, but Someday just getting blown up immediately. He just doesn't have that tankiness yet.
Yep.
Smeb has been so good at proccing all four vitals. I don't think I've ever seen the heal from Fiora happen as many times in a game as I've seen right here. Very consistently setting up winning situations for his team by chasing people down like that.
Yep, that big heal's been helping quite a bit. Look at this, Gorilla just immediately with the taunt onto Someday.
That's a great opening right there. Of course, they get him down to 50% HP, and now he's going to go, gets hit by the Veigar ult.
Yep.
And they're just easily going down. Rocket not going to do a whole lot. Nagne coming in, nearly one-shots Prey, but can't finish it off. Prey then responds.
Cool. So close.
The ace in the hole, not 40, quite enough.
40 HP after that one.
Yeah, now it'll kill. It's the last whisper onto Prey, so much yep. more damage. Caitlyn's hit that four item point of being really, really good in the late game. One inhibitor down. They no longer have the Baron main, so it'll be a little bit harder for them to set up sieges.
And so, crucially, they got a dragon during that conflict as well, just yeah. picking it up at the end, preventing KT from being on the cusp of number five.
Well, it makes that fifth dragon a long way away for the for KT Rolster now. And if you look at the gold lead that Ku has, they've gone from about 4K down this game to now being about 5K up. What a swing.
Well, this looks more like the Ku we were used to in Korea.
Yes,
you know?
Yes it does.
Losing in the early game, scrapping it out, somehow getting their strategy together and just running wild in the mid game to take that gold lead and take a win.
Yeah. Trying to take out that mid inhibitor turret now. They're going to rotate up the top. This is certainly looking like they're going to take this game. We'll see if KT can stop them.
No.
Doesn't look likely, does it? Jazz is just like, no.
The 4-1 they set up was so good, specifically because Smeb is just ignoring the Renekton, and even if LeBlanc rotates over for a quick burst, he's even been able to save his riposte so he can't get burst by Nagne either. Yeah. Just Ku really, really pretty with the way they're moving between lanes.
That Event Horizon, too. Although I suppose with Santa Vigar, it's more like Present Horizon. It works. Someday, try to
try.
Come inside. Yeah.
Try to get some damage down Event Horizon to use just to deny the flank.
They'll get that inhibitor before too long.
About should just make a play right now.
Yeah, well, they need to do
now
something.
Now they should make a play. The Event Horizon's right down.
Yeah.
Well, we got excited for nothing.
Just go for it. Just get him.
Well, they're going to lose their inhibitor. How about that?
Praise, stop moving. Just get him.
And just kill the inhibitor. There's plenty of them now. There we go. Taking out Peekaboo. Takes a big chunk of life loss as well. And Ku Tiger's just going to casually walk away.
Yep.
I think KT had to pull the trigger there if they wanted to get back into this game at
Whoa.
All. They're going to lose a Nexus turret.
Whoops.
At the same time as KT has gotten a bunch of people together in the mid lane just to push out the mid wave. Dragon up at 10. Or Baron, rather.
Two inhibitors down with only one Nexus turret means the Baron would basically only be a chance at a steal.
Probably, and Ku's just going to not waste any time going for this one. KT, they're right there, though. Nagne has his teleport. He could join, and he will. Are they going to be able to get this one? Yeah, Ku gets the Baron, but will they win the fight? Peekaboo takes a bit of damage early on. Gorilla looks a little bit low as well. They're going to take him down. Goodbye, Peekaboo. Nagne over the wall, doing absolutely nothing. Ku just all over KT right now. Nagne has to run. Ace in the hole, blocked by Harrow. Takes half his health doing it, though. And Smeb is getting closer. KT just barely keeping three people alive during that fight. But Ku looking pretty fine. There we go. Teleport coming in. And Kuro, he's got the home guards. Veigar flashing the ball. He better rise it. Harrow cleanses through it, though. Makes it out. That is the most terrifying thing I've ever seen. Nobody wants to see Veigar run at them like that.
Didn't even get the kill, but I feel like Ku will probably get the game. They kill the inhibitor, the instant respawns back up. They have everyone but their support.
Yeah.
Still a decent defending crew there by KT Rolster, though.
It's not bad. Nagne, Arrow, and Someday left. Defend this last Nexus turret and the Nexus. Not doing as much damage as you'd expect, I suppose, but it's enough to scare Ku away. You know, why take that chance? Why take that 80% chance to win right now when you can have 100% chance in a minute or two?
Yeah, and they did just burn two flashes not to get the kill on the Arrow, so there is a little trepidation about trying to finish that game, especially when KT's topped up and score is respawning. I think this
makes sense.
Definitely the right call for Ku. They still got some time left on that Baron to make the final play.
Yeah.
Even so, I'm really loving this series so far. KT,
so good.
Back and forth games with Ku the first two times here. Ku had an early game advantage with Veigar, and they didn't necessarily correctly avoid the team fights and play around the dragons properly. This time, Ku actually had to play from behind. but instead did use the Veigar properly. Much better use of Event Horizon from Kuril this game. They worked around the vision control of KT and found their moments in a very creative fashion. And it's just, it's really good to see two good teams go back and forth against each other.
Well, we were all wondering too, you know, how close was this really going to be after that last series in Korea about a month or two ago? And man, they have not missed a beat as far as how close these teams are to each other skill-wise. I still think we could definitely see a Game 5 in this series. Koo looking like they want to tie things up here in Game 2, though. There goes the last inhibitor turret on the map for KT Rollster. And Koo looking to try to end it. Ace in the hole used, blocked by Peekaboo. But here comes the Koo Tigers. KT, the last defense is right here, right now.
Koo's going to wait for three waves of Baron Battle super minions.
Yeah, why not, man? Get the minions on board as well, too. Arrow takes a ton of damage from Kuro. And there we go. Grand challenge issued yet again. Peekaboo the target. Nagne gonna back out of the fight. Got exhausted. Couldn't really do anything. Double kill comes in for Kuro. They're gonna tear apart KT. And Koo Tigers tearing apart the Nexus as well. Game two goes to Koo Tigers.
This has been a really interesting series so far. And I'm really happy to see Kuro play that Veigar much better in this game than in game one. Because they came back in, played the Veigar again. And if they had lost with it, they would have looked real dumb. But this time, they actually showed that, yes, we know how to use it properly. Last game was just a little bit of an outlier. We can set up these sieges. But KT, they tried to snowball Someday again early, kind of threw away his lead.
I think Someday has no one to blame but himself for this game. He started 2-0 thanks to some really nice play by Score, and then ended 2-7. Not only did he play over-aggressive, I think he built wrong as well with his itemization. Renekton versus Fiora, they tried to bring it out as a counterpick, and I think he ended up outbuilding himself.
Yeah, I mean, in the end, you know, Koo Tigers were able to find those moments that they wanted to in the mid and late game. Play, like you said, very much like the Koo Tigers that we saw in summer season in Korea, and able to come back and crush KT.
I really like what we saw from both teams. It was, I felt like it was really a game of cat and mouse. Of course, KT doing a great job of baiting out those TPs and keeping the map pressure, and Koo just trying and trying and trying until they found the picks that they wanted.
The fact that Koo actually won this game after they had a large deficit in the early game and then failed on back-to-back double TP usages, normally the game is over at that point because you get snowballed on, but they were resilient enough and they saved up. They didn't fall behind because those TPs were used. It was impressive.
Well, that's usually the Koo Tigers that we're used to seeing.
Yeah.
They are very good at staying in games against top-tier opponents and then able to get the strategy working and make a comeback. Their early game dominance has been weird for me to see at this particular tournament.
That's more like it in game two, huh? Well, this series is just heating up. But to help us break down that last match, let's send it down to the interview lounge, guys.
Thank you very much, Doa. Indeed, things just heating up, and we're going to break it down here together with Krepo and the Fisho. Because looking at game two, now all square, and a similar composition or a similar idea also coming out of the Koo Tigers this time around.
Yeah, so what we see for them again with this Veigar pick in the mid lane is they want to do this 1-4 siege composition, where of course Fiora has to do really well up on the top side. That didn't look very good in the start for Koo Tigers because of the ganks that came in, you know, Smep fell behind 0-2 very, very early.
Yeah, KT did a good job of recognizing where Koo was strong to build up their composition. So they took away the 1 out of the 4-1 part, and they took down Smeb in the top lane. He eventually got back later. But I just want to compliment Score on his early ganks, the way he pathed in for a couple really efficient, quick-paced ganks, especially when it went bot later on. We also have a replay of that coming up. So definitely the mechanical outplay he did in the first few ganks set KT up to take the pace of the game and potentially snowball it, but it kind of went down.
Yeah, again, so he gets the good ganks off, and it looked awesome for them. LeBlanc is doing fine in the mid lane and everything, but once we get the counter gank from Hojin coming in, gets the one kill, then Smep gets a solo kill as well up in that top lane, and that's where it really starts going wrong, because Fiora will always outscale a Renekton, and then we get this split push suddenly happening, and we also get to see a fairly weird strategy for KT, where they keep the LeBlanc in the mid lane with Teleport, just sitting there farming over and over. They keep putting Jinx in the bottom lane, give her all the farm. She doesn't apply any pressure. She just pushes the wave and runs away. Why do you pick LeBlanc with Teleport then if you're not going to split push? That's how you're going to close out the game.
Especially knowing that KT had started to build up an advantage. We pulled a replay up on the screen of the bottom lane gank by Score. Also very well executed because it's not just going down there, but you also have to make it work.
Yeah, if you look at where Score is right now, he's on right outside of your screen in the bottom brush. There's okay, Arrow and Peekaboo gonna walk back, and he's just snuck in there. They don't expect him to come in. He's body slams, knows he can't get close enough. Instant R, both of them knock forward. Now look at Peekaboo as well, getting in a position, gonna flash after instant R, and they really play around that Shen shield, immediately go for Prey, then take out Gorilla. This was Score sneaking in here in the bot lane. He went top earlier, got a kill on Swep, so he was definitely directing the pace of the early game. And he got KT pretty far ahead.
But a fairly weird thing, if you look at the replay here, was yes, he made a play on the bottom side of the map. Top side, they just killed the Renekton. There was one ward placed by KT. They've just been dominating 2-0 up there. You have a Renekton that's going to take over the game. Invest vision into that side. Take over completely. Don't allow suddenly the enemy junglers to just walk up the river and get an easy gang off to kind of turn the game around. So there's a lot of mistakes for KT in how they want to close out the games. And again, how they play the 1-3-1, it allows the siege to happen for the Koo Tigers.
I do think it was a good idea, in a sense, going bot lane to take care of the Shen ult
way. But it's fine. I want the top. Vision on top side, so vision, your top lane does not die.
Vision top needs to be better because Renekton should be able to snowball that matchup. And we have to also just question Sunday. Maybe could have had the push the advantage more home. But the biggest thing for me is that in the mid game, once Koo Tigers started actually getting that siege on, we could see the strengths of this composition.
Yeah, definitely. We also have a replay to show that. Much like where in game one there was a comeback from KT through team fight, this time Koo correctly identifies what they're supposed to do with their composition.
Yeah, so some good things about that comp here. First of all, Caitlyn against the LeBlanc, you can just alter every single time before a fight. And then Vega can follow up with his ulti if she ever jumps in or stun her. So this is the 4-1 siege. Look at the bottom lane, Fiora. She will have the Shen support as well as backup.
Yeah, and also just look at where the Jinx is on the map right now. Arrow just way too late to that party overall, and we should have had Nogne split pushing on that LeBlanc. We should have had him clearing the waves. He can dash in to the mid lane to rotate quicker. Worst case, he can even teleport in, so you should definitely have your Jinx in the mid lane there, as you were saying earlier. And
it's just so weird because
it's so weird that they do that.
Caitlyn is sitting in a side lane versus the Jinx. They just keep wave playing against each other. What happens if LeBlanc walks into that lane? Caitlyn dies or she runs away.
She did.
So you take over that lane and you have teleport while Vega is sitting mid lane anyway, just trying to push in the wave. The KT way of playing with this teleport LeBlanc is not really very effective. In the last game, they relied on outplaying in team fights, not on picking off targets or split pushing, even though that
and
that's
they had
what
top snowballing as well.
Exactly. Like that was a. Still a weird game for me that KT managed to turn that one around. That was more misplaced for Koo Tigers in team fights than KT doing extremely well.
And it also comes down to what we thought about Kuro versus Nagne. Monty that's saying Kuro was maybe underperforming, but he played the Veigar here really well. A lot better zoning with the Event Horizon and LeBlanc. As we saw yesterday in that Fnatic game, when it goes off, it can absolutely snowball, but Nagne not taking the best approach to it.
Yeah, and here we see Koo. They should be happy with that game. Yep. They kind of threw away their lead a little bit in game one, and this time, once they played to the strengths of the composition, they quite comfortably won, and KT, they looked a little lost. They had a early game composition where they relied on certain members snowballing. They got them ahead, didn't snowball anymore, and then they didn't move the strong members of their team to the areas where the opposing team was weak. And then obviously, a siege composition like this will pull ahead.
Although for KT going into the next game really quickly, it did come down to a couple of individual mistakes, especially the build path coming out of Sunday as well. So I feel like we might have a 5-gamer on our hands.
He was kind of done so no matter what up there in top lane when you build, like when you play Renekton into Fiora, so that's going to happen. But I'm just looking at the entire team more than just him building some magic resist, because the entire team here needs to play better on the map. They need to be able to push 1-3-1 if they want to run this comp. Otherwise, Veigar is just going to do exactly this every single game you play.
Well, we'll see what happens. And if we see the Veigar again in game three, we might have 5 games on our hands. We're going to take a quick break, but we'll be right back with game three of Koo versus KT. Don't go anywhere.
Gorilla going to play Shen support for the first time ever.
Oh, they got it with the Event Horizon. Will that be enough damage? Gorilla gets taken out by Nogne, though. There goes the support on the other side. Smeb is godlike with a kill there. Nogne comes in, nearly takes out Prey, but it's not enough. Oh, Nogne! Nogne over the wall, doing absolutely nothing. Koo just all over KT right now. Nogne has to run. Ace in the hole, blocked by Arrow. Nogne getting back out of the fight, got exhausted, couldn't really do anything. Double kill comes in for Kuro. They're going to tear apart KT. Game two goes to Koo Tigers.